in Germany, in Hamburg. And we're really, really excited to play tonight. I'm with the band. At my right, I have Mathieu. We founded the project together almost 7 years ago. We searched on the internet for drummers and bass players, and we found Antonin, who joined a few years later. And the latest to join the project was Marine, who's the bass player. We found a name that I think defines the style well. It's called Southern Hard Blues, and it's a mix of the different influences that we have, starting from blues rock or soft rock and to hard rock, and not everything in between, but like southern rock. And yeah, it's classic rock basically, but influenced by southern music and maybe sometimes a bit harder. This is the recording of my vocal teacher that I used to have, and then we recorded the whole session of warming up for the vocals. So I'm trying to do that once before the sound check. Usually it's 20-25 minutes, and once before the show, and particularly tonight because it's outside. So the vocals, when with the cold, it's harder to warm up. So I'm trying to do this good.
Imagine when we are in the van trying to sleep and we hear that right before arriving to the show.
I think now, right now, people just want to go out and see some live shows again. So I guess it's not that difficult to find some shows because everybody wants to go out.
The style of music we are playing is not the most mainstream one. But rock and roll fans are really devoted, and even if we play small clubs and bigger venues, they are still here, and in Germany they are coming more and more. It's great. We can't wait to see the audience tonight.
Before the lockdowns and the pandemic, yes, we were heading towards more and more gigs and more people coming to the gigs. Now, I think with the pandemic, we have a lot of gigs, but it's like we are back 2 years ago. Once upon a time in my dirty fairy tale. So I pray I don't want to play. I don't want to rush, and I don't want to imagine. I think we're on the good way, on the right way. We'll see, but sometimes it's small clubs or small festivals, and sometimes bigger. We are at a point where we can have really ups and downs, I think. And it's, I don't know, it's still a part of the journey, and we enjoy that, I think. We already opened for Jeff Beck back in 2018 in Norway, and it was a really, really cool experience. Band of Friends, the former musicians of Rory Gallagher.
Texas.
But yes. Most of the time we're trying not to interfere a lot. Because all of these guys, I didn't really talk to them except for Richie Cousin, because I don't want to be the fangirl, and I don't like to bother people. So I'm just happy that we are playing with them and opening for them, and just staying in my place.
We met some people that were really, they made no efforts to make the things be good. So,
but most of the time it's not the artist, but maybe the managers, yes, or the wives, or the...
The artists are all really cool, but sometimes they don't want us to be good, and so.
We don't have to just fight against each other to succeed. I think we have space for everybody, and we're so yes. We might as well try to be respectful with other artists and everything, and it's more enjoyable this way. Now, I think if you want to succeed and properly work in the music industry, you cannot just be on drugs and on alcohol every completely wasted every night. I know I wouldn't be able to do this, and I think that if you want to be able to live with the music at the moment, you have to be professional. So we're having fun, of course, but it's a mix of fun and professional. We're trying to see this as a job, even though I think it's the dream job. But we're realizing the luck that we have to be able to tour and be paid for this. So I think it would be a lack of respect to show up completely wasted on stage and not being able to play properly. So we, I think now if you want to succeed and be able to do this, you have to. Yeah, kind of follow some rules, even though it's still you can still have some fun. We're in my apartment, so not far from Paris, but not in Paris because I don't really like the stress and the crowd. It's the suburb. It's a somewhere, it's the bad mix between the city and the countryside. So, I feel comfortable here. I have enough space for myself, my music, my guitars. I used to live not so far from here with my mom a few years ago, and then she said, I'm gonna move to be closer to my work. And I don't know, I always said I hated the suburb, but I guess I got used to it, and then I went past this house and I said, okay, maybe I'm gonna stay here. Most of the time in France, what we're doing is not really touring for weeks and weeks, is touring every weekend. That's what we've been doing the past few years. But when we play outside of France, in Germany or Spain, we usually stay longer because we can't just go back and forth every week. I think it's a good balance, the shows and the life just in a quiet white house. It's a good balance for me. My parents divorced 20 years ago in 2000. There weren't musicians, and there are not really musicians in my family. As a kid, they didn't push me into, you should learn the music, because they loved listening to music, but for them it was more, do you want to... Maybe if you want to find an activity beside school, you could play tennis or dance or judo. And so yes, I was more into, when I was a kid, I was more into sports than music. But my dad, who's English, he always played a lot of great music in the car when we were going for holidays in Austria and everything. He was always playing the music that I think stuck inside my head. The Byrds and Dire Straits and Johnny Cash, Willie Nelson. A lot of country, a lot of classic rock, and I don't think I would have had the same influences if both my parents were French. So I think that was a chance for me. When I was 13, 14, I began being more interested in music. I don't know why, I think it's because I met some friends in school and we were all listening to rock and roll, and some of them were starting to play in a band and everything. So I guess I was a bit caught in this, and I thought, okay, yeah, I really love this kind of music. And for me, the instrument that stood out the most was the guitar, because the riffs and everything, it's really important in the rock music, in the electric guitar. So yes, I started around 14. The first year was that classical guitar with my teacher at home. I was really motivated. The teacher said to my mom, yeah, it's so nice because most of the students that I have are kind of forced by the parents to play classical guitar. And Laura, maybe classical guitar is not what she really wants to play, but she wanted to play guitar and I can feel it, and it feels nice to give some lessons to someone who's interested and not really forced by the parents. Among the movies that inspired me, I think, to pick up the guitar, maybe you're gonna think it's a joke, but it's not. When I was 12 or 13, I saw this movie twice in the cinema. It's a Disney movie, but I think it really inspired me and really motivated me to play the guitar, because I thought, oh, it's so cool. It's a girl who's playing in a rock band. And then, yeah, it seemed so cool at the time. So I thought, I think that was one of the motivation at the time. The equivalent of American Idol, like Star Academy, I think that also what got me into the music. Even though now I'm not listening to this kind of music anymore, I think that I learned a lot of music and discovered a lot of music thanks to these programs at the time. But yes, and now I'm full in the rock and roll way. I didn't think that I would end up a professional musician. Because I thought, not because I didn't want that, but because I thought it wouldn't be possible, that making a living of this is really, really hard. And I didn't even consider this idea at the time. I studied things that didn't really go through, and because I tried studying a lot of things, like translation, architecture, and nothing was working, because I was always so passionate about the guitar that I was always ditching school. And just every morning I told my mom, yeah, I'm going to school, don't worry. And then I was waiting for her to go to work, and then I was coming back home and I was playing all day. So at every end of the year I was saying, sorry, it's not gonna work, Mom, because I did school all year, so no, I'm not gonna pass on the year after. And I realized that if you want to be an architect, you really have to be passionate about that, because otherwise it's not going to work. So in the end, I studied sound engineering, because I thought that that was the closest thing to music that I could have. But at least I had a diploma in case the music is not working, I can do something else. After that, I worked in a music shop not so far from my home, and then I met Chris, so who's my manager and my booker.
Santé.
He was the one who told me, okay, I think it's possible to make a living of your music. We should try. So he started booking some shows, and more shows were coming. And for five years later, we kind of made it. So we are on the right track. I'm really happy about that. But the other thing is that we're really lucky as musicians in France, because we have a lot of help from the government. If you're a good musician and you can, yeah, and you have enough declared gigs and everything, it's easier to make a living, because the government is really helping the music and the arts and everything. So, wait, I'm on Facebook. Yeah, so by the way, I'm in charge of the social media. If people sometimes are wondering, are you the answering on the social medias, or are you in charge? And yes, I'm in charge of the Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. I'm the one behind that. And I like doing that. I don't like making people work for me. If I can do that, then I feel more comfortable doing it myself. Sometimes there are weird people saying, yeah, okay, I know that I wrote a song for you on the last album, you owe me 500 euros. And I was like, no, I don't know you, you never wrote a song for me. So sometimes there are crazy stuff like this. But yeah, 90% of the time, nice people and nice comments, so it feels good. I don't have a big equipment, but it's enough for what I need to do for the band. For example, when I need to record some demos before we go into rehearsal studios to arrange the songs, the new songs together. I have a lot of demos that I need to share with them, so that's why it's practical and easy to have this little installation that we can share the files even if there's a lockdown and we can't really see each other. So for the next album, it's gonna be a bit more of myself. Glad, and it feels so good to be back to normal rock shows. It's not 100% normal yet because people still are supposed to wear masks, and most of the time they're sitting and not standing. We were starting to get used to that, just being filmed, but it's harder to play a rock show without the crowd, because the crowd is really holding you and giving you the energy and that you can give them back. But when there's nobody in the audience, you have to carry yourself and to imagine people in order to be able to give this energy. So it's for me, it asked more focus. The Rock Palace for us was the very first show we played without an audience. Don't want to run away, but I'm already gone. We were thinking in the van during the trip, we really hope that the show is not going to be cancelled, because we hear that everything is cancelled everywhere. So we had our fingers crossed that we would still be able to play, and we got there, and the people from the venue told us, okay, don't worry, the show is going to happen, but you're going to play alone. Usually I like being prepared for everything, knowing, okay, I'm going to talk at this moment and this moment during the show. If there aren't people in the audience, it changes a lot of things, because I have to readjust and adapt everything, because I can't really say, yeah, sing with me.
Why aren't you not answering? That's because the room is empty.
But in the end, it was a fun experience.
Bad luck blues keeps getting in the way. Getting worse and worse every day. Bad luck blues keeps getting in the way. Getting worse and worse every day. Here I am crossing the line. Again, you wanted me out. I wanted it all. At the time, it would have never crossed my mind that such a beautiful face could rip your heart to pieces. You wanted me out. I wanted it all. You wanted me out. I wanted it all. 'Cause bad luck blues keeps getting in the way. Getting worse and worse every day. Getting in my way, getting worse and worse every day. myself to stop running from me. I'm still running to you, trapped all along inside what I thought was life. You wanted me out, I wanted it all. You wanted me out, I wanted it all. That look you keeps getting in my way, getting worse and worse every day. That look you keeps getting in my way, getting worse and worse every day.
Temple of Music in Paris. I think it's one of the last places where you can find everything. Basically, rock. If you're a fan of rock, you must know this place. And I come here from time to time to check out the new things and everything. So today I just wanted to talk about my influences. The first one isn't really an influence, but I wanted to show it to you because that's the first show I went to when I was 7, I think in 1998. I went to see Elton John with my dad in Paris, in Bercy. Obviously you can't really hear this influence in my music, but I really love his music, and I think that's a great memory for me because it was my first show and with my dad. And even though we were sitting at the very last row in a, like kind of a stadium, so very far with binoculars and everything, and I was just waiting for the soundtrack from The Lion King at the time. That was the only thing that I was interested in, but yeah, a nice memory. This one, I know it's a classic for a lot of people, but I'm a bit ashamed to say that, but I rediscovered it really quite recently, a few months ago. I stumbled upon it and I've been listening to this record a lot these past months during the lockdowns and everything. So for me, it was like a rediscovery. And I especially love the, I think Gimme Shelter is my favorite, and You Can't Always Get What You Want. These are my two favorite. And yeah, I've seen an exhibition on the Rolling Stones a few days ago, Unzipped, in the south of France, and it was really, really cool. So I'm in my Stones period right now. Actually, I know it's maybe it doesn't sound so cool, but I don't have a vinyl thing at home, so but I still buy CDs. Every time I discover new music, what I like is buying the CD and put it on my iPod. So I have been doing that since my teenage years, and I'm still doing that. So this was an important CD for me. My dad used to listen to this when we were going on trip somewhere. That's one of the reasons why I fell in love with the guitar, because I got so obsessed with Mark Knopfler's playing, his technique and his sound. In, for example, in Money for Nothing, I remember I loved the intro so much, and I really wanted to recreate this tone and this technique. So yes, for me, this CD was a game changer. You play the guitar on the MTV. That ain't working. If I had to choose, I think, a CD that I could take with me on a deserted island, it would be this one. Because, I don't know, I think it's my favorite album from Airborne. Because it's just raw energy, just pure rock and roll, like AC/DC, but a bit more dynamic. So I really, I never got tired of this this album. I'm still listening to it a lot. And there, for me, there isn't a bad track on this CD. I saw them live maybe almost 10 times. It's a bit violent, but in the crowd, you always get smashed. I think it's, when you see them live, the difference between them and AC/DC is really important, because they're, it's not just a mid-tempo, groovy, hard rock, classic rock. It's more dynamic than that, and I think it brings something else. This, along with the Dire Straits CD, was also what got me into guitar. Playing guitar when I was in high school, I was obsessed with Mark Knopfler and Slash. And Slash for his tone and his solos. And I think I spent, I don't know how many hours, practicing the solo from Sweet Child O' Mine. But it took me a while, many months, playing the same notes over and over again. So yeah, this was also a game changer in my guitar journey. And I think I learned a lot thanks to Slash. So even though it was a lot of hours of work, I don't know how it was in the studio, but I watched some live recordings when they weren't really able to play. It was like, but it was rock and roll, so I don't think people cared so much. The girls, the women, so when I started playing guitar, I think that I was just listening to the music, and no matter the gender, I was focusing on the music I was hearing, and naturally I went towards men's music, because rock music is mostly men music. And I, at the time, I really didn't care, and I, for me, having role models, like Slash and Mark Knopfler, wasn't a problem, because I think I was lucky. My parents never told me, okay, you're a girl, maybe you can't play electric guitar, it's for boys, you have to choose something else. I was free to learn electric guitar, and nobody told me, yeah, you're a girl, you can't do that. So I didn't ask myself any question. For me, it was okay, and I could do that. But now, with time, I realized that maybe some young girls that want, maybe they want to start electric guitar, but if they don't have any female role models, they won't start, because maybe they're growing up in a country or in a city where they think that it cannot exist, and it doesn't exist. So I think now it's important that they see that there are other women playing guitars, and front women in rock bands or in bands in general. So, but I wish it was we don't care no matter the gender, because that's how I grew up, but it's not. So now I'm taking this more seriously. We'll be right back.
liebe Apfelschorle.
Ich trinke.
Ich, no.
Bier.
Oui.
Ich spiele Schlagzeug.
No, but he studied German.
Many years ago.
This is the Gibson headquarter in Paris. It's a really, really nice place.
Yes, yes.
And yeah, they allowed us to use this place. And every time I have some interviews or I want to borrow a nice instrument or anything, they always say yes. So when I started playing guitar, I was really interested in gear, and I always wanted new guitars, new pedals, new amps. Yeah. Too shiny.
This one.
Too shiny.
This one matches with my drums, the color.
And I was more interested in buying gear than playing. So maybe it was a problem. Maybe it was my shopping side, from the woman's shopping side, that went toward the music thing. But yeah, I always wanted new instruments. And now, with the along the years, I had the chance to test a lot of instruments. And when I was working in the music shop a few years ago, and now I feel like I'm totally satisfied with what I have now. So I'm not so much a guitar nerd anymore, because I used to spend a lot of time watching demos on YouTube about this pedal and this pedal, and I don't do that anymore. I just like what I have. So I really love this. This burst and the top, the flames that you can see through, I really like it. And yeah, usually I really like not the most expensive guitar. I think this one is pretty cheap, but it's a guitar that I would like to play, I think. Maybe I could go with it today. I've been playing on a 400 euros guitar recently on tour, and they don't sound bad. I feel comfortable on them. I'm not afraid to play them. So, yes, I think that yeah, with time, I'm just going cheaper and cheaper. I started with classical guitar, but really for maybe 6 months or even maybe less than that. And I quickly switched to electric guitar. If I could give any advice or talk about my favorite technique, for example, because it's a technique that I use all the time. And for me, it helped me a lot, because I'm left-handed, but playing like a right-handed player. So my right hand is really lazy and doesn't want to move too much. So I had to find a way to be able to play fast without moving too much. And I found chicken picking. It's a technique, a right-hand technique, that's mostly used in country music, but you can use it for everything. Instead of playing just a chord like that, you could be doing that. And you can alternate. So, and I don't have to move my hand too much. I have the pick on the A string and my fingers on the D and the G string, instead of playing a, where you have to move your right hand. For me, it's way easier. So that's what I would tell you. If you're a beginner, just try chicken picking. Maybe it's gonna suit you, maybe not, but for me, it works really well. For country, for rock music, that's my favorite technique. So. For me, I know that being a front woman wasn't natural at all, because I don't have the boss, you know, I'm not the boss type, but it comes, I think it's coming with the years. But yeah, and maybe that's also a part of the problem, that maybe that a woman sometimes doesn't feel comfortable driving men in a team. Maybe there's that too. You're walking, laughing at you as you're crawling. Bend to your knees, do what they're telling. Don't meet their eyes, no, they can't sense your fear. I won't back down, I keep my head high. It didn't come quickly, I think. No, for me it took years. Yeah. And it's still, I'm still working on it. But I think you don't have any choice if you're the front woman. Fire, fire, I'm gonna burn the head out of the fire, fire. Fire, fire, tonight we're gonna set the house on fire. somehow have to find a way to lead the band. So at the beginning, I was always saying, yes, 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 don't worry, whatever you want, do what you want, you can choose. And now I realized that I couldn't lead a band like that. I have to be able to say no sometimes. So that's what I'm doing. Even after the shows, at the merchandising, when I'm usually after the shows, I'm going to the merchandising to talk with people. And some people are a bit like they want to hug you really hard, they want to kiss you. And at the time, I would have said, yes, okay, it's my job too to be nice with people. But no, it's not my job. My job is to play music. And if I don't feel comfortable hugging people or kissing them, now I can say no. So, being a woman on tour is fun and not so hard, and I feel supported and I don't know, I'm happy about the team and everything, so I know that if there's a problem I can count on them.
I think for us, for guys, it's hard to have groupie because our public is mostly men. So
and old men.
Yes. Sometimes there are some girls, but we're not looking for that on
just
tour.
Just interested
so.
In me, yeah. So.
Yes.
I spent a lot of time watching YouTubers covering classic rock solos, and it really motivated me to do the same because for me it was kind of a challenge. And I thought, okay, if I manage to cover these solos, maybe I can motivate some other guitarists, other people, maybe young girls that want to start guitar too. So that's why I started doing this back in 2006, I think. I think I was around 15.
Like many of you here, my favorite guitar player is Slash.
I didn't have any plan or any strategy. So at the time, YouTube was quite recent. And the response was really, really good. I was really happy when I got, I don't know, 200,000 views. And then it went up quickly, I think. Maybe that's why I got here today. And I think that's why it worked, because there weren't so many people on this thing, like covering classic rock solos.
Then my second favorite guitarist is Mark Knopfler.
I said, okay, but Instagram, it's too much. I don't want an Instagram. But then I had to create an Instagram account maybe in 2014. And I'm not good at dancing, so that's why I'm staying away from TikTok. But Instagram with these influencers things, I kind of feel a bit not close to this type of things. But for the use that I have, just promoting my music and the band and everything that's about my music, I think Instagram is good. Being a woman in a rock band, it's sad, but you have to work twice as hard to be maybe accepted or feel like you deserve to be where you are. So yes, I'm trying to work hard, and we'll see. In in my, I think, favorite bar in Paris. That's where I like hanging out with my friends when I want to have some beers. I'm with Kevin, one of my best friends. We met in 2014 because we were working in the same clothing shop.
I'm a guitarist too. I'm a singer as well. And she's more an inspiration because she's very successful. And you know, I'm a little bit shy when I have to play in front of her because we don't have the same level. She's better than many, many men I know, including me. And you know, the gender don't have to be a problem. If you rock, no matter if you are a girl or a man, you have to be, you know, treated as the same kind of a person.
It should be like that, but it's not.
It's not so. Like that, I know.
Yeah, I wish. When I have the music and the shows and being on tour, I didn't need more. My main sport was carrying the amps and loading and unloading. So we tried yoga together with some other friends for a bachelor party weekend. And no, it was fun. But we had too much to drink and I felt really sick the next morning. So I couldn't really like be upside down and it was really not comfortable for me. So I just stopped between the before the end of the lesson. But that's something I want to try again.
I got some pictures if you want.
No.
Salut.
How are you doing?
Fine.
Ready for the big collaboration?
Yeah, of course.
I'm with Tom and Buck because we met on a show. I was playing near my hometown and they came to the show.
We had a YouTube channel where we were interviewing bands. That's how we met Laura, actually.
I told them a few months after that that I really had a project to have a signature beer at our merchandising during the shows. Well, that's why I stopped by today to taste some beers and to figure out which one I would like best to be the base of the signature beer.
Last time we talked about you know, the Humber beer, you like this. So maybe we can test this one.
So yeah, I think this would be my favorite because it's more amber and I really like this type of beer.
So it can be a good base to do a better beer for
to
you,
beer
personalized for you.
Yes. I'm not sure I have the knowledge and everything, but I don't know. It's I think it's a part of me that it's rock and roll. I'm in a rock band. I'm not gonna drink wine before the show or champagne. I'm just I like beer. So
yeah, that's it.
The drink of rock and roll. So yeah.
Cheers.
Thank you.
So this one is more on malty flavors, and you really have the cereals going through your mouth. A small fruity flavor in it because it comes from the yeast.
Mm-mm.
It's not about the hops, it's really about the yeast and then you have like a real nice color, it's almost reddish.
Yeah, the color looks great. And I'm sure it's gonna be my favorite.
And there is not so much sugar in it, so it's like a bit dry.
You can drink a lot.
Yeah, I was saying you're not gonna be bored with it I love beer, but I don't really know how everything works. So I think they're going to explain how they do it.
So to start, we go with the mash tun.
This one?
A vessel, yes, where we put water at 65 degrees.
Okay.
The water is going to take the sugar off the malt.
Yes.
We take all this liquid with the sugar, we put it into the boil tap, and this is the place where you put the hop. The hop gives the bitterness and the aroma. You have a lot of different hops that give different aroma, like fruity or herbal. When we have finished this, the beer is almost ready.
Okay.
We have to transfer it into the fermenter, make it cold very fast.
Yes. And that's where the bubbles and the sparkling thing arrive?
Okay. Yeah. If you want to explain.
Yeah, because we have to put in the fermenters at 20 degrees. The yeast are going to turn the sugar into alcohol and they will produce some bubbles.
Okay. And can you decide the level of sparkling and bubbles that you want depending on the...
Yeah. Okay. You can just close the doors and everything so the bubbles stay inside of the beer. And so after 3 weeks there is the worst part of it. We have to put it in the bottle and it's
really drink.
Long. Yeah,
and
drink. It's really long, but then after you can drink it, so it's okay.
This is the best part.
Yeah,
okay. It's the best
part. This is why we are doing this.
We are working with some rock bands because we have a lot of friends in the rock industry, small bands, but we really enjoy that because it's always like really fun to create something with a band and to get their identity and to put it in the beer.
One day to talk, one day of research, and one day of brewing, and 1 month to wait for the beer.
15,000 beers a month.
A month.
So yeah, only two.
So if you want to work with us, send us mail.
Nowadays, it's really common because there is a lot of small breweries in France and in Paris. So we are a lot like this, but some of them are really big and some of them are really small. And yeah, we are on a small scale, but not the smallest.
In the end, we're supposed to... we're not going to be rich with this, but I think we're all going to make a bit of money. It's going to be ale fire, like hellfire, but ale, like A-L-E, fire. Mad Max design, like, you know, apocalyptic design with like me. On my guitar, like if I was on a broomstick with a helmet. It's a good thing to try, so it's a bit different from the usual merchandising CD t-shirts. I really wanted to try that. So. We are the ICP studio. That's the studios where I recorded my latest album, and I'm going to come back to record the new album. I feel like home here. The studios are so nice. A lot of equipment, like maybe you can see. You can check in the hallway. There are a lot of vinyl CDs and records that have been recorded, particularly, I think, French artists and Belgian artists, but also bands like Royal Blood. We had the nicest studio possible and engineer for the last recording.
Tu m'entends? On va reprendre au début de la chanson? OK, c'est parti.
He's the best, but he's like me, professional but nice.
They say you need someone to follow, need a guide to show you the real life.
We're not gonna reinvent anything because it's like everything has been done, but I still think that being a French rock band and playing like American music is something special already. All the different influences that we have and that I have, going from classic rock to southern rock to country rock, in the end it just feels like us. So.
Here's to war, here's to power. Here's to digging your grave deeper.
I think when you're making music, you're not thinking about the sales first. Or at least I'm not. Maybe it's the job of other people. But I think for like playing old school rock and roll, it's important to release physical CDs and vinyls, because the people that are listening to our music are still people that are buying physical music.
Okay, we do it again. Just send the tape.
To know that the lyrics, for me, it's always the hard part, because I always considered myself more as a guitarist than a singer. So the guitar is coming first most of the time, and then sometimes the lyrics are coming easily, but sometimes not. So I'm just stuck with an instrumental track for a while. For the previous albums, we used the main rock and roll themes, like being on the road, rock and roll, alcohol, but. For the next album, I think I'm going to get a bit more personal, and I got my influences from books, movies and TV shows and things like that, the outside. So I always considered music as a passion and a pleasure, and if I'm mixing this with really, really important topics and things that are more serious, I'm scared of losing the fun of the music. So. For me, it's a different. I think I'm playing music more for people that had a rough day at work, and then they just want to go out and move their head and have a good time. I don't want to put them into other problems, and that there are bands that are doing this really, really good and really well. But I don't think that's my. That's not my way of seeing my music.
Seeing life through the eyes of the devil, looking for some kind of hope through your screen. Same lies, same promises. You wonder, is there anyone you can trust anymore?
In this industry, women have to work harder than men, and I can hear that and read that on the comments, for example, on YouTube. Like, okay, but yeah, she's famous just because she's good looking, or just because she's a woman, or just there are always reasons that I'm kind of famous, because not because of the talent, but because of a lot of other reasons. And yeah, if I want to prove them that and even myself that I'm there and I'm here for the right reasons, I want to work harder, and I need to work harder to prove like I have my place here, and I'm in my place. I'm not scared about the future of the rock scene, because of course, at least in France, and I think in every part of the world, it is not the most popular kind of music at the moment, but I'm really, really glad we have new rock bands and blues rock bands that are emerging. All our idols like AC/DC and Slash and Everybody's Gonna Die at some point. Not now, I'm not saying it's over. But then we need a new generation, and I think this generation exists. So I'm really relieved that we have this. Maybe it's going to come back. Maybe it's just a question of like what's fashionable at the moment, what's the trends and everything. I'm not sure where new bands are going to fill stadiums, but I think they're still going to be able to live from this.
Need to rap fast to fly away.
I can't remember.